And now, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Valter Longo.
Now, maybe I'm going to stand down there because I don't think I'm going to be able to see this otherwise. Okay, well, thank you very much for coming. And I'm Valter Longo. I'm a professor at USC, actually the director of the Longevity Institute. And my passion since I actually was 19 years old, other than music, when I was a jazz guitar player in Texas, I decided that I wanted to study aging. And since then, all I've done is to study aging. And then I think in the last 15 years or so, I really became passionate about using this knowledge that we acquired for aging, how do we age, to prevent and treat diseases. So we now, I'm not going to talk too much about that, but we started a number of clinical trials all over the world using some of the things that we learned about aging and the molecular mechanisms of aging, using this to treat cancer, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's, etc. So my book is actually not in English yet. It's in Italy, in Italian so far. My home country is Italy, so I wanted to do it in Italian first. And it's doing very well in Italy. And so soon it's going to be here. But I just included my Facebook page that I use to keep people informed. I have one in English and one in Italian. So if you're interested, you can follow me on Facebook. So one of the questions that I always, to sort of get to the why aging issue, one of the questions that I always ask is, if we cured cancer completely today, how long more do you think we will live, or you will live? What do you think? What's a guess? Yeah, some people here, I hear they're educated on that topic. Yeah, so most people, at least most of my students, they say 25 years, 20 years. Yeah. And actually, it turns out to be about 3.2 years, right? Completely cure cancer, and obviously, cancer, as you know, is the number two killer in the U.S. and probably very close to number one. And but even if we cured cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, we would only get 13 years, 13 extra years of life. And so if we were half as effective as we already been in intervening in the aging process in mice, in people, we would get about 30 years. So 30 years of healthy life, right? So this is very important. And the reason for this is that if one of these diseases doesn't kill you, another one will, right? And this is... And all of these diseases are really, the foundation for all these diseases is really the aging process. So for example, an epithelial cell gets older, eventually accumulates mutation, and that's what ends up being a cancer cell, and or a neuron, and the glial cells in the brain, they get older, they become dysfunctional, and eventually there's an inflammatory process going on, and then you develop Alzheimer's disease, right? But at the center of all of this is the aging process of all these different cells. So how do we stay young? And really, people always say, well, you are a gerontologist, you're working on the aging process. I always say, I've never been so that interested in the aging process. I'm much more interested on how to keep somebody young, right? And because there's many details there about the aging process that are really irrelevant if you find out what the program is that keeps people young for such a long time. And this I'll show you some of the opinions. And so Gertrude Baines, some years ago, was the oldest person in the world here in Los Angeles. And she felt that she got to that age because she never drank or fooled around. And I'm embarrassed to say that Salvatore Caruso, who made it to 110 years of age, was one of the oldest persons in the world up to a few years ago, had a similar idea of how he got to 110 years of age, very healthy. No wine, no tobacco, no Venus. That was his motto. And Some disagree, and this is Madame Calmont, and Madame Calmont actually reached the record, the historical record, at least recorded and demonstrated, for longevity. She made it to over 122 years of age in France, and as you can see, she smoked until she was 117, actually. And actually, she did not quit because of health reasons. Obviously, she was 117. She quit because she was embarrassed. She couldn't light up anymore. So she said, you know what? I'm just going to quit. It's very similar to Emma Morano. I just went and visited her. I was there for the 117th birthday. And this is amazing because if you think about it, she is the, in a few months, she's going to be the third oldest person in the history of the planet, right? So this is really remarkable, right? 117, still very healthy. And I got a call from the New York Times a couple of years ago saying, you know, how is it that she eats 3 eggs a day, eats meat, and you're talking about all this vegan diet and all this. And so how is it possible? Okay, so this is really what I'm going to talk about today. And so... treat aging is our focus. How do we get to this 117 years of age healthy? And also, what is the explanation? Why Emma Morano and Madame Calmont could do whatever they wanted and still make it to this age? So we know that if you have the right genes, and this is very rare, so people like to say, well, of course, that's what the New York Times was saying. If she made it to 117 eating eggs, everybody can eat eggs, right? Well, it turns out that the part they didn't talk about is that every single one of her brothers and sisters, and she has 6 or 7, I forgot, and her mother and father all made it past the age of 90, right? So the chance of that occurring by mistake is probably 1 in billions and billions, right? So we know that if you have that many people in the family that all made it to age 90, you just were born with all the right genes. And this is extremely rare. But now, back in the early 90s, myself and a small group of people, mostly scientists, mostly in the United States, I was at UCLA, others at MIT, Harvard, UCSF. So a small group of us started saying, well, we need to figure out what the genes that control aging are. So what does Emma Morano and Madame Calmont, what do they have that is so powerful that can keep them healthy and living so long? And so I first started with humans, and I realized very rapidly that was never going to lead me anywhere. Why? Too complicated. So then we all moved back to simple organisms. I actually started studying this unicellular organism called yeast, that what we use to bake bread, right? And this is very, very much studied in the biochemistry and molecular biology field. And others used the flies and the mice, and so we all identify these genes that are very powerful in keeping, in making this organism much longer. In my case, I was able to make this small organism 10 times longer live. So they live 10 times longer than normal. In this case, about a double lifespan, and these little mice here live 50% longer than these big mice here. And the only difference between this and this is a mutation in the growth hormone receptor. One single mutation makes them live 50% longer, but more remarkably, it makes them live much healthier. So everybody thinks, well, you're going to extend the lifespan, and it's going to be a sick, longer life, right? And instead, these mice are much, much healthier, and they live 50% longer. So if you look at diseases, half of these little mice never develop any kind of disease, right? And even the disease they develop, oftentimes, they say tumors, they're often benign instead of malignant. So there's a remarkable difference. And it's interesting, we're investing very little in this intervention, this anti-aging intervention, versus what I call the band-aid approach. Wait until somebody has cancer, wait until somebody has Alzheimer's, diabetes, and then desperately try to do something about it. Of course, at that point, there's not much you can do, usually, or very limited ability to act. So obviously, we knew these small organisms were so long-lived and so protected, and so I obviously wanted to know about the people. And UCLA, Hassi Cohen told me, well, if you want to study the people that have the same mutation as these little mice here, then you have to go to Ecuador and talk to Jaime Guevara. And Jaime, it was an endocrinologist, and he was the doctor of 100 of these subjects. This was very lucky for me, because now we had a group of people that had the same mutation that we knew had record longevity extension in mice and made these mice super healthy. So is it possible that that people could have the same benefit? So Jaime and I started studying this subject. So I invited him to Los Angeles, and then eventually I went down to Ecuador many times. Now I go a couple of times a year. So we started studying them, and at the beginning, I thought, Ecuador, they must have a good diet. You know, they probably like in the mountains of the southern Ecuador. And instead, they did not have a good diet. And a lot of them were overweight and obese. And I thought, this is never going to work. There is no way that this group here is going to be like the mice long. But we started, of course, we studied them anyways. And it turns out that whereas the deaths from cancer in the relatives is what you expect, what it is in the United States, so about 20-25% of the deaths are due to cancer. In the Larons, in this subject here, there was only one single death from cancer in the last 50 years, right? And so this is 100 patients, but then Zvi Laron in Israel and Europe confirmed with another 250 patients, so out of 350 people, there's only been a single death from cancer in 50 years, right? So it's really remarkable if you think about that. These are mixed people that are mixed all over the world with other genetic backgrounds. So it's got nothing to do with Ecuador, nothing to do with the environment. In fact, we compare them to their own relatives living in the same houses, right? So these relatives are relatives living in the same house. So it means the single mutation in a gene can completely help prevent cancer in 350 subjects for all these years. And then we looked at other diseases, and as I just mentioned, the obesity, they're almost twice as much, they have almost twice as high obesity as the relatives, the Ecuador population. And yet, and obesity, as you know, is one of the most important risk factors for diabetes. And in the controlled Ecuador population, there is about 5% prevalence of diabetes. I mean, 5 out of 100 Ecuadorians have diabetes, which is very much expected. And so far, zero for the Larons, right? So they can be obese. And when they came here to USC, actually, the endocrinologists were shocked. That's impossible. None of these subjects have diabetes. So eventually, we did publish a number of studies showing why they don't have diabetes. Well, main reason, they're protected from aging, but they're also insulin sensitive. So they're insulin, they make little insulin. The insulin works very well in spite of their obesity. Okay, so then they say we brought them to Los Angeles, and we were interested in their brain. So everybody started saying, well, they're protected from cancer, they're protected from diabetes, they probably have higher cognitive impairment and cardiovascular diseases. They thought it was just a balancing, right? Yeah, protected from something worse than something else. So we brought them to Los Angeles to do fMRIs, right? To test with some of the leading groups here at the Imaging Brain Imaging Center at USC. What are they, in fact, as people suspected, worse for cognitive performance? And so, thanks to some of the scientists involved, Caro Nashiro and Meredith Brasky, we did all kinds of tests using this MRI techniques called functional MRI. And this is just a test where they asked to remember objects and whether they're new objects, they similar to what they see before or the same as they saw before. I mean, this is just one of the many tests that we did. But the only thing I'm going to tell you about is that the Larons, which are here, have even, they were both about 40 years of age on average. And at this point, at 40 years of age, you already have a decline in cognitive ability. And so I'll just make it very simple. They basically have, at 40, they have the profile of much younger subjects, right? So if you look at this, which is the older Larons, small people, they very much look like normal young individuals, whereas the control, their own relatives, which we also brought to Los Angeles, look just like the older adults, right? So they seem to be, their brain seems to be protected against cognitive decline. And thus far, we have not, it's very preliminary and very premature to make any conclusions, but thus far, we haven't seen a single case of Alzheimer's disease, right? So which is remarkable. So these results in humans are very important, but also more important is the parallel with the mouse studies, right? So the mice don't get cancer or have a lot less cancer, are protected from diabetes, and are protected from age-dependent cognitive decline, right? So we're same things. So the coincidence that these humans and mice that have the same mutation will have the same phenotypes in all three diseases is very, very small, I think, you know. So it's possible all of this is a coincidence, but very, very unlikely. Okay, so we're developing drugs to go after this growth hormone receptor, but this is a very long process, and so the rest of my talk is really about diet. So first, I wanted to tell you about the blue zones. A lot of you probably already heard about the blue zones. Dan Buettner has done a lot of work on these blue zones and described them for National Geographic. And basically, these are areas of the world. There are five. We added one to it in Calabria, Italy. But there's five regions, which is Sardinia, Costa Rica, Okinawa, Loma Linda, and Greece, right? And they have these people that are very long-lived and they're also relatively healthy. So what do they consume? And I start first with the Mediterranean diet. To give an example of something that works a little bit, is protective, but is still very distant from the power of the very specific diets that I'm going to talk about in a second. So this is what most people recognize as a good, healthy diet, right? So high consumption of legumes, cereals, fruits, vegetables, some fish, moderate consumption of cheese, yogurt, wine, and low consumption of meat. And, you know, of course, when you do many studies on the Mediterranean diet, it turns out to be protective compared to the other diets. But these protections are really in the 5, 10, 15% range, right? So you may see cancer reduced by 5%, 10% compared to somebody that has a standard, let's say, American diet. So very good, but still not that powerful. Now when you start pushing it to a limit, and in this case it's a big study of thousands of people by Estruc in Spain, and they took thousands of people and they randomized them and they said, you're either going to go on a low-fat diet or you're going to go on a Mediterranean diet that is very high in olive oil or nuts, right? This is a New England Journal of Medicine publication. So a lot of olive oil, so 150 ml. So basically a liter of olive oil every week or so. That's a ton of it. But they had to stop the study because the people that were on the Mediterranean diet, plus olive oil or nuts, were doing so much better than the people on the low-fat diet that it was unethical to continue. So on year five, they stopped it to allow the other people to also go on the high-fat diet, high olive oil, nuts diet, right? So again, though, this is a very, very good result, right? But still not a dramatic result, as I'm going to show you in a sec. So what about Loma Linda here? What about Californians that do all the right things or close to it? And so Gary Fraser, nearby here in Loma Linda, has been studying this Adventist for a long, long time. And it turns out that the men Adventists live on average, they do all the right things. They are normal weight, non-smokers, vegetarian, exercise regularly, consume nuts regularly. They live an average of close to 10 years longer than the typical, the average Californian. Now a step further, Okinawa, Japan, and now we have a diet that is even more getting closer to the what I call the longevity diet, you know, the topic of my book. You know, what if you do all the right things? And the Okinawans, at least historically, now they don't do this anymore because now they're starting to eat more like we eat here in the U.S. But you see the Okinawans, whether it's coronary heart disease, these are the Okinawans, the Japanese in general, and the Americans. So big difference in the risk incidence of heart disease. Here in this case, a tenfold difference in females. Colon cancer, twofold difference, threefold difference. Prostate cancer, a sevenfold difference, right? All the Okinawa. So all the Okinawa diet, which is basically a vegan diet, a little bit of fish, a low protein diet, a lot of greens, right? So a more extreme version of what the Loma Linda and the Mediterranean people do. See, breast cancer, again, fivefold difference. Lymphoma, threefold difference. So this can make a tremendous difference. And now we know that the people from Okinawa, when they move to the United States, they start acquiring some of the same problems that we have here. Okay, so then what about the longevity diet? So what do we know, what have we done in the lab that now can even take this further? So we knew about the connection between protein and growth hormone. So what I showed you, the little people of Ecuador, they're lacking this growth hormone receptor. So almost like they have no activity of the growth hormone receptor. And also something called TOR. And this is controlled by proteins, right? So then the question is, what happens if you look at the Americans that have a low protein diet? And what happens is the following. If you look at the 65 and below population, this we published a few years ago, if you looked at the 65 and below population, and then you follow them for 20 years, the high protein group, the one that has more than 20% of the calories coming from protein, has a fourfold increase in cancer incidence, the risk of cancer incidence, compared to the people that have less than 10% of the calories coming from proteins. And also a 75% increase in overall mortality, in dying of all causes, compared to the people that have the less than 10% calories. But then, if you look at the 65 and older, and this is was really upsetting for me, because when I asked the graduate student to go do this, she came back and said, high protein, low protein, no difference. Because she had looked at everybody as a group, right? 65 and below and 65 and above. And it turns out that the 65 and older cancel out the 65 and younger, meaning that at older age, a higher protein intake is now protective, right? And you know, and people say, I remember when we first published this, there was a doctor, I think it was on the Good Morning America or one of the shows, she's like, very confusing. And I was thinking, here's a doctor, we just published on this, and he thinks it's confusing because it says two age groups, right? Well, guess what? You have to face the confusion, and now you know it's important that doctors are now starting to get trained in this type of knowledge, right? Because now you have to have different diets at different ages. It's not that complicated. You just need to know what you're doing, and then it's fine, you know. And so, what's the explanation? This is just one of them. There's probably more than one. But you see, this is the same growth factor that the Larons, the little people, have very low, right? And you see here, the people that had the highest protein intake have a very high level of the growth factor, right? And this level has now been shown over and over and over by many groups to be associated with colon cancer, breast cancer, prostate cancer. And now you see the low protein group here, it comes way down to the safe range, right? So now, but this is 65 and below. If you do 66 and above, all that goes away, meaning that the growth factor is already so low in the older subjects that further decrease in protein is now not beneficial to you anymore, right? So this is just one of the things. That we also suspect that in most cases, the people that were on a low protein diet and they were older, like say 75, 80 years old, maybe they were not doing it to be healthy. There were people that may have been malnourished, frail, et cetera, et cetera. So this is probably a complicated story, but say for sure we can say that having enough proteins and maybe more of a variety of food if you're 70, 75, 80 year old is a good idea. So we now recommend that people that get to that age, even though they were vegan or pescatarian all their lives, maybe it's a time to differentiate a little bit and start eating more variety of food, as you saw for Emma Morano, that made it to 117 years of age, eating 3 eggs a day. Okay, then science again is very important. So what if you take a lot of mice and you feed them all kinds of combination of food, and then you ask the question, which one lived the longest? Without having an opinion, and this is a work done by a group in Australia, and it turns out that if you use the Atkins diet, so if you have the high protein, high fat diet, you eat less, and you lose weight, including some fat, but your metabolic health is worse, and your lifespan is worse. Now, if you have a low protein, high carbohydrate diet, and this is not a high sugar diet, it's high complex carbohydrate, the one you get from vegetables, the one you get from grains, whole grains, etc. So you eat a little bit more, you have a little bit more adiposity, but in spite of that, you have better metabolic health and better lifespan. And this matches well, these five blue zones, the epidemiological data. And in fact, here is a study by Harvard looking at 120,000 people, follow them if they were on a low carbohydrate, high fat, high protein diet. They lived the shortest and they had the most diseases, whether it was cardiovascular disease or cancer. So especially if it's animal-based, high protein, high fat diet, it's gonna shorten your life. Okay, so then proteins are very key in activating these genes that accelerate aging, and with them, the age-related diseases. The other side is the sugar, not the carbohydrate, but the sugar, right? So if you now have a lot of, particularly if you're pre-diabetic or diabetic and your sugar level now are high all the time, now that's a problem, right? Because now this is pushing the second pathway that controls pro-aging genes. It's called PKA, protein kinase A. And so how do you intervene? Well, one way to do it, a famous way to do it, is almost 100 years old. It's called calorie restriction. And this is a very simple intervention. Basically, you reduce the calorie intake in all kinds of organisms by 30% from normal. Not from high, but from normal. For what would be a normal intake of calories, reduce it by 30%. And if you look at rats, and then I'll show you, of course, the primate data, the remarkable thing, they live longer, but more remarkable, as I showed you for the growth hormone mutations, there is about 5 times more disease-free animals that make it to the end of life, right? So you live longer, healthier. And this is the same that we see for the monkeys. And these poor monkeys have been put on calorie restriction for 30 years. This is done at the University of Wisconsin and the National Institute on Aging. So you see the effects are really remarkable. So on the normal diet, 63% of the animals have some type of age-related disease. And on the calorie-restricted diet, only 26%. Diabetes is 60% on the normal diet, zero in the calorie-restricted diet. And tumors and cardiovascular diseases are reduced by 50%. So these are really extraordinary. And these are our monkeys, are not mice, right? So these are extraordinary results telling you that calorie restriction is extremely powerful. So that a lot of these problems that the Americans and the whole world has are not really necessary, meaning that they can be prevented. For most people, they can be prevented, particularly diabetes, but also many, many of the cancers. Not all of them, but certainly many of the cancers. So what about people? So my boss, when I was at UCLA in the early 90s, was Roy Wolf. Roy was one of the pioneers of calorie restriction. He had been studying this for decades, and he was a medical doctor at UCLA and my PhD mentor. And when I first got to UCLA, I was talking to Roy through a camera, basically, because he was locked up in this Biosphere 2 environment in the Arizona desert, right? So him and other 7 people went inside of this place, and they were sealed in, and they stayed there for 2 years. And sure enough, somehow, Roy was able to talk everybody into becoming calorie restricted. Now, it's a long story. They ran out of food, and there was all kinds of complications. But certainly, the first human calorie restriction experiment started in 1991. And if you look, I'm just going to show you one slide of this, but if you look at the results, are really remarkable. If you look at, this is where they enter the biosphere 2, and this is when they're in biosphere 2. This is their body weight. It drops dramatically. But look at the systolic blood pressure. It goes from 110 to 90 systolic. Glucose level from 90 or so to 70 fasting glucose. Cholesterol from 190 to 125. So again, what we've seen in the monkeys, we see in the people, that all these things that often we see as unavoidable are actually completely avoidable. But there's a problem, right? That calorie restriction is extreme. And if you look, I didn't mention it earlier, but if you look at the monkeys, even though they did not have all these diseases, they did not live that much longer. They lived longer than calorie restriction, but not that much longer. Why? Because this is Roy Walford normally, and Roy Walford had a very good diet. And this is Roy Walford in the biosphere 2 while calorie restricted. Very extreme, right? So now you see how that person is probably going to have all kinds of other problems that you normally would not have, right? So, for example, sensitivity to infectious diseases, problem with wound healing, the problem of sustaining anesthesia, right? And so this is why the monkeys probably did not live as long as they could have, because they were pushed to a limit. So very effective against diseases. So how do we get the benefits without the problems? And so I started thinking a long time ago, I was like, how is it possible that you take two 40-year-olds and they have 40-year-old eggs and 40-year-old sperm, and then this relatively all sperm and all egg get together, and now all of a sudden it's a perfect zygote, right? So there is something in the body that is able to basically rejuvenate, reset everything. And the question is, what is it that is so effective here in zeroing all the problems that were present in these old cells, right? And so we knew that from my studies at UCLA, I knew that if I starve bacteria, I starve yeast, or worms, all kinds of organisms, they live longer. And this is very counterintuitive. How can it be that you starve a system and you think it's going to die immediately, and instead it lives longer, stronger, right? Very bizarre. So I started thinking, sooner or later I'll go back to this. And sure enough, eventually I went back to this and first did this with mice. So I took all mice, and came up with this, what we call fasting mimicking diet. So it's a diet that fools the system into thinking that it's starving completely, right? So by using this, what I just told you, the knowledge of the connection between nutrients and the genes that control aging. But it turns out the same gene also controls regeneration. So if you starve, if you give these cycles of the fasting mimicking diet to mice starting in middle age, by the time you get to old age, this is the level of white blood cells in young mice, and this is the level in old mice. And this is the level in all mice that have been going through these cycles of fasting and refeeding, fasting and refeeding. And so it's rejuvenating the immune system. And we know that the immune system is the most important factor against cancer. And now, as you know, it's also being used very widely to treat cancer. So what happens to tumors? You see that the mice that undergo just a few days a month of the fasting mimicking diet have almost half of the tumors. And these gray dots are the tumors at the specific age in the control diet, and the red dots are in the fasting mimicking diet group. You see all these tumors here are avoided by the fasting mimicking diet. So as soon as the mice start the diet, it just wipes out all these tumors for 4 or 5 months completely. And pushes them back, but at the end, you still have almost health. And a lot of the tumors are benign instead of malignant. Same story that I've been telling you over and over, right, with the mutations in the mice. And so it looks like by intervening on the aging process, we can not only reduce extend the lifespan, but also reduce or at least postpone many of the diseases. So now rejuvenation of the immune system, and this immune system is now going after the cancer cells and is able to guard against both benign and malignant tumors. And the end result is also a lifespan extension. So these mice live 11% longer, and also they live 18% longer if you consider the 25% death moment, meaning the moment when 25% of the mice are dead, which is right here. Okay, so what about humans? So we then did a clinical trial at USC where we say, okay, let's do a human fasting mimicking diet. Very similar to the mouse one. It's about 1,100 calories on day one, 800 calories on day two, three, four, five. And then we just give it to people, and we ask them to do nothing different than they normally do. So they'll eat exactly the same and exercise exactly the same as before, but just once a month, they take this box, they go home and eat only what's in the box, right? Which is a fasting mimicking diet. And well, first of all, I ask people, how long do you think you can go without food completely? 7 days? 10 days? Some people here are educated on the subject. Yeah, no, you can go 60 days, right? The majority of people can go 2 months with no food, right? Of course, you're going to die after the 2 months, but you can make it to 2 months on average without no food. But it's interesting, see, because most people think it's 7 to 10 days, right? So if you think it's 7 to 10 days, then 5 days without any food seems like, oh, I'm almost going to be dead. And of course, even doctors think it's about 10 days, right? So then doctors are very scared. And I think they should be, because water-only fasting, if you don't eat at all, it's a very extreme intervention. It should only be done in a clinic. And so I strongly discourage it. But the fasting mimicking diet is, I just want to point out, emperor penguins can go 5 months with no food at all, and they use it while they're going back and forth from their colonies to the open sea. Okay, so the fasting mimicking diet is really a vegan diet, and it's really, again, it's a high fat but good fat, the vegetables. We have all kinds of tricks in it, right? So it's like 66 different components, and everything is adjusted to come up with something we call nutri-technology. Now, you heard about biotechnology, and this is, we call it nutri-technology. So to you, it's just food. To us, it's a way to orchestrate all these different genes that promote protection, rejuvenation, the activation of stem cells, and the regeneration of systems and organs. Okay, so then just some example of what this does. So if you're a subject, that, and these were 20 to 70-year-old subjects, and we tested 100 of them in a randomized trial. If you're normal, if you have normal blood glucose, and you do three monthly cycles, once a month, 5 days, for 3 months, and we measure them at baseline before they started, and 1 week after refeeding, and then we measure them again 3 months after stopping. So if you're a normal subject with normal glucose, it didn't do very much. It just had a very small change in glucose. But if you were a pre-diabetic subject, now it drops the fasting glucose all the way to the normal range. And same thing, IGF-1. Remember, this whole lecture has been about IGF-1, right? So people that came in and they had low IGF-1, normal, good IGF-1, like the low-protein people, like the Larons, right, the ones that are super protected, it came down a little bit, because in the U.S., it's very hard to find a person that has low IGF-1. Most people had actually fairly high. Even the normal one had fairly high IGF-1. But it comes down by about 20 milligrams per deciliter. But if you look at the people that are at risk for cancer, people that have, remember the 240, actually these are 280, so very high levels of IGF-1, very much at risk for prostate cancer, colon cancer, breast cancer, etc. You see big drop. And this drop occurs after they went back to the normal diet, meaning that something has really changed in the function of the body So instead of putting a Band-Aid like Lipitor and cholesterol, right? These are Band-Aids, right? You're not solving the problem. You're not saying, well, why do you have high cholesterol? What are you trying to do with cholesterol, right? The cholesterol is there to do for a purpose. The liver doesn't make cholesterol just by mistake, right? It's trying to do something. It's confused about something. It's trying to make this cholesterol. So you block it. Are you really solving a problem? Well, it turns out you don't, right? Because yes, you reduce cardiovascular disease, maybe, but eventually the mortality is about the same, right? So it's important to fix the problem. And how do you fix it? And I think the fasting-making diet is really one of the ways to do that. And so here, C-reactive protein, one of the inflammatory markers, systemic inflammation markers, and also risk factor for cardiovascular disease, effect on normal people that had normal levels, almost nothing. Effect on people that were at risk for cardiovascular disease, you see a big effect again. And again, it's going after the systemic inflammation problem. It's fixing the problem from its source. And how does it do that? Well, in mice, we demonstrated it by activating stem cells. So here, the normal diet, the level of circulating stem cells in the people, and here you see what happens in during the fasting-mimicking diet. Now, the body's turning on a stem cell to fix the problem. And so what happens during aging, diet, aging, toxins, this increases the risk for disease. And this fasting-mimicking diet basically is able to turn the clock back a little bit. It, of course, doesn't make you young again, but certainly turns it back a little bit. We had a person that did the several cycles of the diet, and then he went to one of these companies that checked his biological age, and they told him that he had lost 12 years of biological age by doing this. Of course, this is N01, but certainly it was interesting that an independent company would test them for biological age and determine that he had lost 12 years of biological age based on this marker. So this is really decreasing diabetes, cancer, cardiovascular disease, and Alzheimer's risk factors. And that we in mice, we know that it works for this purpose of decreasing the disease. We now also know genetically that this type of intervention is very powerful, as I show you for the Laurent, in preventing diseases. And now, we got to do more work, and we're going to go to the FDA soon and start testing these on thousands of people FDA-approved intervention. Okay, so why does it work? It's actually very simple. Right, so here's Roy Walford normally before he entered the biosphere. And then, as I showed you, Roy Walford during biosphere. And so during the fasting, this, of course, is months and months and months of being pushed to the limit, right? But during the fasting, much less extreme, between here and here, if you looked at his liver, the liver here was probably about half of the size that his liver here, right? So now you kill half of the cells of the liver, basically, right? And then in the period following this, you rebuild it, right? So within maybe a month or two, is now, this is after he exited the biosphere too, is now back to the normal size. So, and this is the muscle, the heart, the kidney, the liver, the hematopoietic system, the blood system, on and on and on. It's almost every system. Why is that? Because during starvation, the body needs to save energy, essentially, right? Want to save energy. So if you're not eating, why do you need the liver to be the normal size? You know, this liver is used to disintoxicate the body from a lot of the things that come in from outside. Nothing is coming in, no need. And also, you do not want to support the energy of this liver all the time, sucking up energy for no reason. So you just get rid of half of it, right, or close to it. And then you rebuild it, but now you just rebuild half liver that is made of new cells, right? And the same for the muscle, the same for all these different systems. For example, we just finished a clinical trial on multiple sclerosis, and over 70% of the patients, after 7 days of this fasting-mimicking diet, had lost over 20% of their white blood cells, right? Seems like a negative thing, but it's not, because within a few days of refeeding, they build them back again. So now it turns out that a lot of the cells that were killed were the autoimmune cells that were attacking the spinal cord. So the body, remember I said, how does the body know 40-year-olds out of get rid of the problems and generate a perfect zygote and baby? Well, the body has got all the program within it to understand what's a bad cell and what's a good cell. But by eating all the time, as we're doing now, it just never gives an opportunity, as it always had. I mean, every organism, remember I showed you bacteria, yeast, but even people, our history is very frequently we were without food. And this is the first time in history of the humankind that we eat all the time. And we never, in fact, a lot of patients that in the clinical trial had headaches. Why did they have headaches? Because the body, after 5 or 6 days on this diet, turns from using sugar as a fuel to using fat as a fuel. And they probably haven't ever used this system. Right? These enzymes that are in the brain, and they've always been used for this purpose. To a lot of people, they were never utilized. So they had to turn them on for the first time. And this is probably why it's causing a delay in the use, and the brain is confused, and they cannot utilize this fat. It's called ketone bodies for energy generation. So I'll just end with the longevity diet. So mostly plant-based, vegan, plus fish. I think this is the ideal diet, at least up to age 65, 70. But then people after 65, 70 tend to start losing weight. And at that point, I think it's better to start differentiating more, let's say, milk, goat milk, and goat cheese, right? So these are some of the things we see in these blue zones the elderly consume. So this is the yogurt from goat milk. These are some of the things that can start being added to the diet and I think are very, very healthy. Maybe some white meat is probably not a bad idea after age 65, 70. Until then, high levels of legumes. I mean, all this can go all the way to, you know, 117 years of age. But I think, you know, after 70 it has to be modified a little bit. So high levels of legumes, so the beans, the garbanzo beans, the peas, et cetera, et cetera. Healthy fats, olive oil, I told you about, nuts, the salmon, these are all things that are very good. And actually, in my book, I talk about 30% of your diet, of your calories, should come from these sources. So high nourishment, this is also very important. A lot of people go from eating a lot of meat to a vegan diet, and they become malnourished because now they're starting to lack B12, zinc, calcium, et cetera, et cetera. So you go from one problem to another. This is very common. And occasional long periods of medically supervised fasting. And for people that tend to gain weight, 2 meals a day. So we hear all the time is 5, 6 meals a day. And this is really contributed to this obesity epidemic in the United States. As you know, 70% of Americans are either overweight or obese. And I think we have to thank this bad idea of 5, 6 meals a day for that, because it's impossible when you tell people eat all the time, they're going to overeat a little bit of the time. And even if it's just 5 calories extra, you do it 6 times a day, that's 30 calories extra a day. At the end of the year, it's 10 extra pounds, right? So then we should go to 2 meals a day if you tend to gain weight, and 3 meals a day if you tend to lose weight, or even more. You know, again, some older people tend to lose weight, not gain weight. And in that case, in fact, older people benefit from extra fat and benefit from extra sugar. Very, you know, most people don't know this, right? So people that are having a little bit of extra fat, if you're 80 years old, it's better to be a little bit overweight. And we don't know why yet, but that could be due to reserves, right? So again, pick a doctor that is very good at and understands these things, because this can make a big difference. And I'm just going to end. I hope there's volume on the computer. Is there volume? I mean, for the there's a music. Yeah. This is Salvatore Caruso at 107. Yeah, guys. Thank you. Okay, so we have time for questions? Or no, we don't.